In the beginning, God created the universe, and within it, a planet called Earth. God's spirit hovered over the dark and empty surface, speaking life into it. Light appeared. Sky and land split from the oceans. Trees and plants grew. Days and nights began, and all kinds of creatures filled the earth. Humans were formed in God's image to continue God's work. Things were really good. But soon, humans decided we want to live our way, not God's. In their struggle for control, selfishness and violence filled the world. So God started over with just Noah and his family. A few generations later, God made this covenant to a man named Abraham. The land around you, as far as you can see, is now yours. Your family will be as many as the stars and will be my blessing to the entire world. Years passed. Then miraculously, in their old age, Abraham and his wife had their only son, Isaac, just as God promised decades earlier. Later, Isaac had twins, Jacob and Esau. Then Jacob had 12 sons. The youngest, Joseph, moved the family to Egypt, saving them from a famine. There, they grew into a large nation, a people called to be different, to remind everyone what it looks like to live in God's ways. Abraham's descendants, now called the people of Israel, were moved to Egypt by Joseph to save them from a famine. There they grew into a large nation. The Egyptians welcomed them at first, but soon this turned into fear and jealousy. The Israelites were forced to be slaves and do hard labor. But God heard their cries of pain. Through a humble leader named Moses and incredible signs and wonders, God led the Israelites in a great exodus back toward their promised land. As the Israelites journeyed through the desert, God guided them with a pillar of fire at night and a cloud by day. The Israelites complained about being hungry and abandoned. So God sent birds and sweet flaky manna for them to eat and made fresh water pour from a rock. God even lived in the middle of their camp in a sacred tent called a tabernacle. Along their journey, God gave them special instructions called laws and commands, guiding the Israelites to live differently, to show others how to follow God's ways. But the people complained. We don't want to live by these rules like slaves again. Living their own ways, the Israelites wandered the desert for 40 years. After decades of complaining and struggling in the desert, a new leader named Joshua charged the Israelites back into their homeland. Miraculously, God stopped the flow of the Jordan River so they could safely cross. God warned, "Drive out everyone who lives in the promised land, or they will corrupt your lives." But the Israelites didn't listen, intermarrying and worshiping the false gods of the people who remained there. Soon, God's protection was removed, and other nations overpowered Israel. In their defeat, they suffered, begging God for help. So God sent judges to lead them in battle, defending the promised land. In victory, the people worshiped God, but soon after, they turned from God and lived their own rebellious ways. This became a pattern from generation to generation. This was a time when everyone did what was right in their own eyes.
So if you're just joining us for the story, or you missed a week or two or three along the way since we started the series, you're all caught up now. I don't know why it took 8 weeks to get us up to what we could have covered in 3 minutes like we did right there, but you're all caught up. You know, it's good for us to go back and review. It's good for us to do a rewind, and I don't know, there are some movies like that I like to go back and I like to see again. Have you ever had a movie like that? That there are some movies I could see over and over and over again. For instance, I love the Jason Bourne trilogy movies. I have seen those. Way to go, guys. They're awesome. And I've seen them all, and anytime they're on TV, I'm just a sucker for them. I'll watch them again and again and again. I never get tired of them. Now, my wife Barbara, on the other hand, she does not like to see movies a second time. She's kind of a one-and-done type of person. When she's seen a movie, she's done with it, with one exception. There is a movie that she has seen multiple times in the theater and, I don't know, probably 30 times on television. Pride and Prejudice with Keira Knightley. She falls in love with Mr. Darcy. I might have had to watch it a time or two myself, actually. So this weekend is for all of you. We're going to look at two chapters of the story, chapter 8 and chapter 9. Chapter 8 is really a story for all of you who like the Bourne Trilogy movies like me. It's full of war and blood and guts and sex and, you know, it's all that kind of stuff. And chapter 9 is for those of you like Barbara who like Pride and Prejudice. It's a love story. Now, to get into it today, to set it up, I want you to watch this video.
I wonder what it's going to be.
I want a toy.
What is it?
I want a toy.
What is it?
I want a toy.
How do you know it's not a toy?
I want a toy.
Open it up. Let's see what it is. Whoa.
I want a toy. I want a toy.
Aunt Val brought you a princess shirt.
I want a toy.
Look how beautiful you can be in that princess shirt.
I want a toy.
That's not very nice.
Okay, show of hands. How many parents have had a Christmas morning like that at your house? Yeah, almost universally true in the room. I heard somebody say one time that grandchildren are God's reward for not killing your own children. Now, as adults, we get disappointed like that, and we still feel that way where we open a present and it's not what we wanted, but we're better at disguising it when we get disappointed by a present. For instance, if you're married, you know what it's like to have a spouse who just doesn't get it, right? Like, you tell your husband, you know, I want these shoes and I want this size and this is just going to be perfect. But he wants to get creative. He wants to think outside the shoebox. And so for your birthday, he shows up with this gift and you open it and it's like a box of Nutrisystem or something. It is like the worst possible gift you could have ever gotten. Or guys, you want like the new iPhone and you're all excited about that and you get the gift and it looks the right size and it's about the right weight and you open it up and it's like nose clippers. You get not what you wanted, but what you need, okay? I just wonder if some of you have experienced some moments like that in your life recently, you know, where it's like, I want a toy. You graduate from college, you have all these dreams of what it's going to be, but there's no job, and so you move back in with your parents. And it's not what they want. And it's not what you want either. You opened the box, and it wasn't what you thought it was going to be. Or you get married. You grew up a Disney junkie. You just think it's going to be, you know, they live happily ever after kind of thing. And now you're trying to deal with the disappointment and the disillusionment of your marriage. For centuries, the Israelites had had a dream of being a free people. For centuries, they dreamed of the promised land that God had promised to their forefather, Abraham. And they finally arrive in the promised land. They are miraculously given this land of milk and honey. But like a spoiled little child on Christmas morning, they just couldn't be satisfied with the good gift that God had given to them. Turn to chapter 8, page 103, if you have your story Bible. I call chapter 8, I'm going to call it today the Bourne Trilogy, and you're going to figure out why in a few moments. It's hard to imagine, but these promised land conquerors who God had helped miraculously deliver the land to, they didn't share the stories with their children, with the next generation. These children grew up not knowing what God had done for them, and the result of not passing on God's story had devastating consequences on the succeeding generations, just as it does in our day. So look on the third paragraph of page 103. It says, after the whole generation had been gathered to their ancestors, what does that mean? After this first generation who had gone into the land with Joshua had been gathered in the sky, they died with their ancestors. Another generation grew up who knew neither the Lord nor what he had done for Israel. Then the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord and they served the Baals. Now that verse right there is the beginning of a cycle in Israel that got repeated over and over and over again, and it looks like this cycle right here. The Israelites would fall into sin and idolatry, and they would start worshiping false gods, the Baals. And then God would kind of remove his blessings for them, and they would get enslaved by a foreign power, a foreign entity. Well, they didn't like being enslaved again, so they would repent and they would cry out for God to do something about it. And God would raise up what are called judges, which are like national and spiritual leaders of the people. And then through those judges, God would deliver them. But then like spoiled brats who were saying, oh, you know, I'm getting tired of this. I want a toy. I want a toy. I want a toy. They would fall into sin and idolatry again. They would get enslaved by a foreign power. Then they would have to cry out to God, and God would raise up a judge, and he would deliver them again. And this would get repeated, not once, not twice, not three times, not five times, 13 times. This cycle right here. In a 330-year period that the book of Judges covers, only 110 of those years are lived in peace with God. Only 110. So this cycle gets repeated 13 times. God raises up 13 judges in this cycle, but chapter 8 of the story just tells us about three of them. Thus, I'm calling it the Born Trilogy. Now, the first judge we meet is in chapter 8. Her name is Deborah, and she is one tough, capable, and strong woman. On page 105 of the story, God tells Deborah to recruit a general named Barak. No relation, by the way. To go and fight a general of an opposing army named Sisera. Now, that seems like a very unfortunate name to me for a general, military general, to be named. I am General Sisera. Well, General Barak says, I don't know if I can do that. If you'll go with me, Deborah, I will go. But if you don't go, I won't go. And she says, well, certainly I will go with you. But because you're being a coward about this, the hero of this story is going to be a woman. The glory of the battle is going to go to a woman. And everybody reading the story thinks, oh, Deborah's going to get the glory, end of story. But no, actually, it's not Deborah that gets the glory. Fast forward. Barak beats up General Sisera, and Sisera gets whooped, and his whole army is decimated, and Sisera runs away, and he tries to find a place to hide, and he finds the tent of a woman named Jael. She says, come on in here and hide. I'll keep you safe. She says, lay down on my bed. I'll cover you up with a blanket. He says, you know, I am so thirsty. Could you get me a drink of water? And she comes with a flask of warm milk. And he goes to sleep, and she covers him up. Now, the next to the last paragraph on page 106 says, but Jael, Heber's wife, picked up a tent peg and a hammer and went quietly to him while he lay fast asleep, exhausted. She drove the peg through his temple into the ground, and he died. That's hardcore, isn't it? Holy cow. She drives a tent peg through his head, pins him to the ground. And I appreciate the fact that the Bible adds, and he died, because we wouldn't have known that otherwise. Just then, General Barak and the Israelites come breathlessly to her tent looking for Sisera. And he says, have you seen my enemy, Sisera? And she says, why, yes, I have. He says, where is he? Oh, he's in there on the ground, laying in a pool of blood with his head pinned to the floor. And Deborah's prediction came true that a woman would be the hero of the battle. Now, the Bible doesn't say this, but you just know the next time that Jael and her husband Heber had an argument, she said, honey, you look tired. You ought to go take a nap. And he responded, no, I'm fine, really, I'm fine. Now, the second judge in the Born Trilogy here is Gideon. Gideon was just a farmer from the lowest tribe, from the lowest clan, and God called him to do battle against the Midianites. Now, the Midianites have so many soldiers, they're like locusts all over the land. There are 135,000 Midianite soldiers, and Gideon is leading an army of 32,000 soldiers. He's way outnumbered. And God says to him, Gideon, you've got way too many soldiers. You don't need that many. And he's like, what? You can't have too many soldiers. That's like saying there's too much bacon on the buffet. You cannot have too many. And God says, thin it back. He said, I want you to tell everybody who is scared that they can just depart. 22,000 soldiers leave. He's down to 10,000 now against 135,000. And God says, ooh, still too many soldiers. It's like, what? God says, I want you to take the guys down to the springs, and then they're going to drink from the spring. And whoever laps up the water while they drink, like a dog laps water, that's who I want you to keep, just those soldiers. And he's like all nervous. How many am I going to have left? 300. Now it's 300 against 135,000. And God says that's good, because now the glory will go to God instead of to Gideon. God says, here's the strategy. Give every soldier a trumpet. Give every soldier a jar. Give every soldier a torch. And give every soldier a sword. Now, you're not really going to need the sword. That's just kind of for show. Okay, now what do we do, God? Well, here's what you're going to do. You're going to surround the 135,000 Midianites at night. And on cue, you're all going to take your jars and break them at the same time. Then lift your torch and blow your horn. That's the strategy. Break the jars, lift your torch, blow the horn. So they do. They surround the camp at night. Midianites are asleep. It's middle of the night. They break the jars. The noise of that so upsets all the Midianite soldiers. They wake up. They think they've already been invaded. They think there's a great army of Israelites among them. It's dark. They can't see. They pull their swords, and they just start slicing and dicing willy-nilly, whoever it is, and it's all friendly fire. They are now killing each other, and they just decimate one another. They're in total confusion. And the Israelite soldiers are just leaning on their swords going, wow, this is cool, God. And they went in to clean up the mess after it was over. I mean, what an amazing story. The odds were 450-1 against them, and yet they won. That's the story of Gideon. Incredible faith. Now, the story says on top of page 112, over to the right a few pages, it says, no sooner had Gideon died than the Israelites, again, one more time, prostituted themselves to the Baals, the false gods. Now, the last judge in the Bourne trilogy here in chapter 8 is a guy you may have heard of named Samson. Samson was physically strong, but he had a great weakness, and his weakness was women. He was a he-man with a she problem. Now, the secret to his great strength was his long hair. God was giving him this supernatural strength. It was his long hair. But one day, he traded God's secret for Victoria's secret. I work on these all week, folks. Delilah was Samson's lover. Delilah was not a believer in God. She was from a different religion. God had told the Israelites, don't intermarry because, you know, those people will mess you up. And the Philistines, though, come along and they offer Delilah, in our day, it would be the equivalent of $25,000 to find out the secret of Samson's strength. And so she comes up to Samson one day and she says, honey, how'd you get to be so big and strong, you big hunk of beefcake, you? And he said, well, babe, you know, the secret of my strength is, he said, if you tied me up with 7 strips of leather that have never been dried, I'd be as weak as any other man. And so she lulls him to sleep, and she ties him up in 7 strips of leather, which is kind of 50 Shades of Grey kinky here going on. And she wakes him up, and she says, Samson, the Philistines are coming. And he jumps up, pops the leather strips, and just beats the bejeebers out of the Philistines. They go back to their barracks, bruised and bleeding, and they are really ticked off at Delilah. Now, you would think Samson would say to Delilah, how dare you try to kill me like that? But instead, she says, Samson, I'm so hurt that you lied to me. You made fun of me. Tell me the secret of your strength. And so Samson goes through 2 very similar scenarios, And each one he lets loose on the Philistines who try to take him down. He says something that's not true. And now she's really mad. Now you got to read this. Turn to page 117. Third paragraph from the bottom, about two-thirds of the way down the page. You are not going to believe this. Then she said to him, now this is after she's tried to kill him three times. How can you say I love you when you won't confide in me? Guys, we are just morons, aren't we? This is the third time you have made a fool of me and haven't told me the secret of your great strength. With such nagging, she prodded him day after day until he was sick to death of it. Oh, I'm just sick of that. I guess I'll tell her. And he tells her the truth about his hair. And he goes to sleep, and she shaves it off. And when he wakes up, he can't defend himself. His strength is gone, and they grab him. They bind him. They gouge out both eyes, and they throw him in prison. But at the end of his life, Samson, broken, helpless, decimated, turns to God with one final plea. He's standing chained between two pillars of their temple, and there's lots of people there. And Samson asks God to strengthen him one last time to get revenge on the Philistines. And that day, God strengthens him, and he pushes the pillars, and the temple comes down on all the people gathered there, and he kills more people that day on the day that he died than any other time in which he lived. So this is the cycle of the judges. This is the Bourne trilogy. Sin and idolatry, toward the Baals, they would get enslaved by a foreign power. They would cry out to God, you know, that God would raise up a judge and then God would deliver them. Everything would be great, but then it was, you know, I want a toy. I want a toy. I want a toy. And round it goes. And where it stops, nobody knows. They just couldn't see God's great gifts because of their own rebellion. And some of you know all too well, you've had like your own cycle in your life where it's kind of, I want a toy. And you know the chaos of living life on your own terms. You know the chaos of living life without even considering God. Well, in the midst of all this chaos of the book of Judges, the book of Ruth begins. Finally, ladies, we're to the love story now. It's Pride and Prejudice time. And chapter 9 of the story begins on page 121 with the words, in the days when the judges ruled. In other words, this is going on at the very same time that we read about all those stories in the book of Judges. So the book of Ruth takes place in the midst of that chaos. And there was a famine in the land of Canaan, the promised land. We don't know if it was judgment from God or if it was just, you know, a famine that hit. Could have been judgment after all their disobedience. But a guy named Elimelech decides to move his family away from the promised land to a foreign country named Moab. Now, the name Elimelech means my God is king. But he didn't live up to his name. Instead of trusting in the one living God, he goes to Moab and trusts in their food supply. Now, his wife's name was Naomi. Naomi means sweet and pleasant. And they had two sons, Mahlon and Chilion, which had bizarre names. Mahlon and Chilion means sick and dying. Don't name your kids that, okay? Yeah, I'd like you to meet my boys. Here's bird flu and walking pneumonia right here. So as the story unfolds, these two boys, they move to Moab, they grow up, they become adults, they fall in love, and they marry two Moabite women. Again, not believers in God. But by the time you get to the end of the second paragraph of chapter 9, you feel like you're reading a Nicholas Sparks novel or something. I've never read one, by the way, but from what I'm told, tragedy strikes. Naomi's husband dies. We don't know why he died. We don't know if it was old age. We don't know if he had a heart attack. We don't know if he got hit by a camel. We don't know what it was. He dies. And then shortly thereafter, the two boys, sick and dying, die. Oh, that's a big shock. So now you've got three widows. You've got Naomi, and her two daughters-in-law, and they're all in grief, and they're sharing the Kleenex box with each other. Well, Naomi decides after her husband's death that she needs to move back to the promised land, to her homeland, to her hometown, because she was a foreigner, and there was nobody to take care of her in this new place, and there was no churches to watch out for them. So no help in Moab. But her daughters-in-law were so fond of her that they decided they would go back with her to her homeland. But part of the way down the road, she tries to stop them. She tries to convince them to don't go with her. Go back to Moab. She says, basically what she says to them, you girls don't need the baggage of a mother-in-law hanging around on you. Go find yourself another man. Well, one of them, Orpah, turns around and goes back to Moab. Orpah, isn't that a great name? I tried to convince Barbara. We ought to name one of our girls that. You know, Orpah Apple, I thought, had a wonderful ring to it. She didn't agree. And so Orpah goes back, but the other daughter-in-law, Ruth, decides to go with her. And Ruth makes a statement to her. It's about two-thirds of the way down the page, on page 122. Ruth says, where you go, I will go. And where you stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people, and your God will become my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord deal with me, be it ever so severely, if even death separates you and me. Now, does that sound familiar to anybody? Where have you heard that phrase, where you go, I will go, and where you stay, I will stay? Anybody? At a wedding vows. You'll hear that a lot of times at a wedding. And yet, where this verse comes from was not originally between a husband and wife making this kind of commitment to one another. It was Ruth making this statement to her mother-in-law. So actually, you know, at a wedding, if you were going to do this right, there would come the time in the wedding when the wife would turn away from the groom and turn to her mother-in-law and say, where you go, I will go. I predict that's a tradition that's not going to catch on. What do you think on that? Probably not. So Naomi and Ruth make their journey back to Naomi's hometown. They go across mountains, and her hometown is Bethlehem. Oh. Bethlehem, ring any bells to anybody? I mean, once we hear Bethlehem, we start to get one little indication of why this story, this little lower story in the Bible, might be important to the upper story that God is writing. Now, at the time, Bethlehem is a town of less than 200 people. And so when Naomi returns, it's big news. Naomi's back. People start to talk. They say, is that her? Doesn't look like her. She's changed. Now, remember the word Naomi means pleasant or sweet. They say, is that really Naomi? She doesn't look like the same pleasant, sweet self. Naomi says, look, don't call me that anymore because God has made my life bitter, not sweet. Next to the last paragraph, page 122, don't call me Naomi, she told them, call me Mara, because the Almighty has made my life very bitter. I went away full, but the Lord has brought me back empty. Why call me Naomi? Why call me sweet and pleasant? The Lord has afflicted me. The Almighty has brought misfortune upon me. Can't you see the expression on her face at this point? She's angry. She's ashen. She's got dark circles under her eyes. She's bitter. She's mad at God. God has not held up his end of the bargain. I wanted a toy. I wanted a toy. I wanted a toy. And I wonder if that sounds familiar to some of you that are here today. You just reach this point where it feels like what you hoped for, what God was going to deliver for you, or what God was going to give you, you felt like just hasn't worked out. And so you read the story of Naomi in the book of Ruth, and you think, well, this is really a story about loss. Naomi lost her home, she lost her land, she lost her husband, she lost her sons. It's a story about loss. But my question is to you is, does it have to be a story about loss? Does it have to be a story about loss, or is there something else? I mean, she loses a lot, incredible pain and loss, but is that what the story has to be about? Gerald Sitzer was in a car accident. He was hit by a drunk driver in a minivan, and he lost three generations of his family in that accident. He lost his mom, he lost his wife, and he lost his young daughter. He wasn't even hurt. And he wrote a book about going through that journey, and he titled the book, A A Grace Disguised. I love that title. And here is what he says. He says, the experience of loss does not need to be the defining moment of our story. Now, it would be one thing for me to say that. It's quite another thing when what he's gone through when he says that. That the experience of loss does not need to be the defining moment of our story. And he goes on to say the defining moment can be our response to the loss. The story doesn't have to be about the loss. The story could be about our response to the loss. In other words, we don't get to decide what roles we play in our story in life, but we do get to decide how we play our roles. And so you reach this point in loss, you reach this point in your story where you decide, is this loss going to define me? Is this going to be what my story is all about, loss, or is my response to the loss going to define me? That's hard, and I think it was hard for Naomi not to just get caught up in the pain of the lower story that she's in while God was writing a great upper story. We tend to get focused on what's happening right in front of us. We open the box, and instead of a toy, we find a sweater, and, you know, instead of, you know, the shoes, you get the Nutrisystem. It's not what you wanted. It's not what you planned on, and there's disappointment. But here's what we're going to see. If there's one word to describe the story of Naomi, it's not loss. It's redemption. Naomi and Ruth arrive in Bethlehem. And their first thought is, how are we going to survive? Second paragraph, page 123, says, and Ruth the Moabite. By the way, seven times in this book, it refers to Ruth the Moabite, just like it's pounding into our head. Don't forget, this is the foreigner. This is the woman who worships false gods. This is not a follower of the true God of Israel. It's just like to remind us that, you know, wrong woman, wrong place, wrong time, all those kinds of things. And yet, there's a book of the Bible named after this non-Hebrew woman. We're going to find why. And Ruth the Moabite said to Naomi, let me go to the field and pick up the leftover grain behind anyone in whose eyes I find favor. Ruth goes out to the harvest fields. There's the barley harvest going on right now. And she starts picking up grain that's left behind by the harvesters. And actually, there was law in that day that if harvesters dropped grain, they had to leave it behind for the poor people. It was kind of their welfare system in that day. Next paragraph. Naomi said to her, go ahead, my daughter. So she went out, entered a field, and began to glean behind the harvesters. As it turned out, she was working in a field belonging to Boaz, who was from the clan of Elimelech. As it turns out, wouldn't you know, just so happens, coincidentally, go figure, the story just unfolds, coincidentally, that she ends up working in Boaz's field, who is a wealthy, single, godly guy who, unbeknownst to Ruth, is a relative of her late husband. Now, to make a long story short, Boaz befriends Ruth, and he really takes a liking to her. And when Naomi finds out about this, she played Cupid, and she said to Ruth, here's what I want you to do. I know where Boaz will be working tonight, so I want you to wash. I want you to put on your best perfume. I want you to put on your prettiest clothes. You look nice, and then you go to the barn where he's working, and after he eats, he will lie down, and he will go to sleep, and you go lie down at his feet, and he will tell you what to do from there. You say, what is she telling her to do? Well, it's not what you think. This is anything but a hookup, okay, that's going on here. This is something very cultural that was going on in that day. Actually, it was a proposal. Naomi was telling Ruth to prepare herself as a bride and to announce. Actually, she's a very liberated woman here. She's like proposing marriage, to propose, you know, to Boaz, hey, I'm available and I'm willing to relocate, okay? So I'm interested in this. Now listen as I read what happened next, as it's paraphrased for us in the Living Bible. This is a paraphrase. Suddenly, around midnight, he wakened up and sat up startled. I mean, you know, he didn't know what was going on, wiping the sleep out of his eyes. There was a woman lying at his feet. Who are you? He demanded. It's I, sir, Ruth, she replied. Make me your wife according to God's law, for you are my close relative. Thank God for a girl like you, he exclaimed. I guess so. He says, now don't worry about a thing, my child. I will handle all the details, for everyone knows what a wonderful person you are. Isn't that great? Now, Boaz is called all throughout the scripture repeatedly here, a guardian redeemer. Guardian redeemer. What is that about? Let me explain the guardian redeemer law to you. When a person fell onto hard times and they were forced to sell their lands, and when the Israelites went into the promised land, they all got a portion of land. When you fell on hard times and you were forced to sell a portion of your land, there was a law that allowed for a guardian redeemer, a relative, to step in and to buy the land so that it wouldn't be lost to that family's tribe. Now, I know that seems weird, but this is so it would stay in the family, so it wouldn't be lost. So Boaz comes along, and he's a relative of Elimelech, you know, Ruth's father-in-law, and he says, I will take responsibility, Boaz says. And that is no small act of kindness and sacrifice here, especially when you consider that when you get the land, you get the people who come with it. And Ruth is a Moabite. The men of that area would have nothing to do with a Moabite woman. But actually, there was a closer relative than Boaz who had the right of first refusal on this. So Boaz, he kind of deliberate, he sets this all up. He goes to the guy who had the first refusal of the land and the family, and he says, there's this land, and you can have it if you want to redeem it. Oh, and one other thing, you probably need to know that when you acquire the land, you get Ruth, the Moabitess, you know, that foreigner, you know, she was from Moab, kind of, and you get this mother-in-law, this dead man's widow, in order to maintain the name of the deed on the property. Isn't that great? I mean, this is like you're buying a house, and you don't know why it's so cheap, and you say to the realtor, well, why is it so cheap? And they say, well, you know, there's a mother-in-law that lives upstairs and she comes with the house and she likes people to call her bitter. You'll probably really enjoy her. And at that point, the guy says, I'm out. You can have it, Boaz. Buy it yourself. So on page 127, third paragraph, ladies, this is the big moment. Don't miss it. Your Pride and Prejudice moment. So Boaz took Ruth, and she became his wife. When he made love to her, the Lord enabled her to conceive, and she gave birth to a son. What a beautiful story, right? I mean, this is an amazing man. He has no legal obligation to do this. There is a relative closer than him, but it's just pure grace. And what does Boaz get out of the deal? He ends up getting an awesome wife. What was Boaz's life like before this story happened? Ruthless. Oh, come on, that's funny. That's the only thing you're going to remember when this sermon is over, right there. Boaz comes along and says, I will buy the property. I will take responsibility. I will redeem this foreign woman. Now, As it turns out, if you were with us last week, you know who Boaz's mother is. Do you remember a prostitute in Jericho who helped two spies who came in to spy out the land, who helped them? Her name was Rahab. And as it turns out, Rahab had a son. And as it turns out, her son's name was Boaz. And Boaz grew up to be a man who honored God. And perhaps his own mother, who at one time had been, you know, this foreign woman, foreign land, foreign culture, his mother changed from worshiping pagan gods to worshiping the God of Israel. Maybe with all of that, he had a special place in his heart for Ruth to show her comfort and grace and generosity and protection. I mean, it was as if the Christmas present was opened, and at first it looked really dumb, but then when you opened it up, something on the inside of the box was better than you ever could have imagined. So here's what I'm saying to you today. You get a present, and you open it up, and wow, it looks about the right size, what you were hoping for. It's about the right weight. You shake it around, and you think, man, I can't wait to tear into this thing. So you open it up, and you look at the box, And you're like, that's not what I wanted. Abuse, death, terminated from a job, addiction, widowed, infertility, debt, job loss, pain, divorce, poverty, cancer, adultery. It's just loss. And that's what it looks like on the outside. And you're like, wait a minute, this is not what I signed up for. I want a toy. I want a toy. But this does not have to be your story. Your story does not have to end with on what's the outside of the box. And what I'm saying is, before you stomp out of here and you walk away from God and you say, God, I can't take this anymore, before that, you ought to open the box and you ought to see what's inside. So that's Naomi, and that's Ruth. And they open the box. And they look inside and they find out there's going to be a grandson for Naomi. And she's going to have a reason to live again. And that grandson is going to bring a future to them that they hadn't depended on. He brings hope and a future. And it brings a blessing into their family. They couldn't have seen at the start. They didn't know how this was all going to work out. And in a way, this kinsman redeemer, Boaz, brings salvation to this family. I mean, it's just an awesome story. They didn't know what they were going to get inside. And you get down to the end of this story, the final picture that we have in Naomi in this book is she's holding her grandchild, and it closes with these important words right here. And they named him Obed, this child that was born to them. He was the father of Jesse, the father of David. Ruth's great-grandson is King David. Is this an awesome story or what that's happening right here? I mean, this is just very cool. Ruth's great-grandson becomes King David. Because you can't always get what you want, but if you try sometimes, you might just find you get what you need. So you got to see the family tree here. It's just an amazing family tree. Rahab, prostitute from Jericho, has a son named Boaz who marries a Moabite wife named Ruth, and they give birth to a son named Obed, who gives birth to a son named Jesse, who gives birth to a son named David, who became the king. And what they couldn't see is that years later, in a little town of Bethlehem. Why Bethlehem? Why did Mary and Joseph go back to Bethlehem for the census? Because they had to go to where their lineage came from to register for the census. And it was there in Bethlehem where they couldn't see it all the way down. Deep down in the box that they couldn't even see at the time was Jesus. And he was waiting for them. Now that is an awesome story, isn't it? That's an awesome story. And if you're listening today and if you've unwrapped the box and you didn't like what it said on the outside, I want to encourage you, keep looking down deep inside. Keep looking for what still is ahead. And you say, I can't right now. I can't even get any. I've prayed. I'm prayed out, Gene. I would encourage you to make your prayer today, those words that Ruth said to Naomi, pray it to God and say, God, where you go, I will go. Your people will be my people. I will follow you. And I will trust that, you know, when you can't see what's going to happen, is that down the road, when I'm saying, I want a toy, I want a toy, I want a toy, that you can bring about something that it couldn't even imagine. You can bring about a redeemer, a guardian redeemer for me. Listen, loss does not have to define your story. Your response to the loss is what your story's going to be about. God has a redeemer. You know, you don't even have to try very hard to get to communion from this story. Boaz, guardian redeemer. He was qualified to redeem because he came from the right family. He had the right riches. He had the right heart. Jesus redeemed us because he came from the right family. He had the right riches. He was sinless. And he loved us. God so loved the world that he gave his son. The price of our redemption. Boaz had to pay a price for the land, had to pay a price for Ruth and Naomi. The price for our redemption was the body and blood of Jesus, the bread and the cup. Let's pray together. And I'm going to ask those of you who are going to help with communion while we've got our heads bowed, you just quietly slip out. Go prepare. Some of you came in today and boy, your eyes are on the box and you don't like what the box says and you wanted a toy and maybe you need a redeemer and maybe today you just want to ask Jesus Christ to redeem you, to redeem your circumstances, to give you patience while you can't see what's down deep inside. You can't see what's going to come in the future. You can't see how it's all going to get unpacked. Maybe you could trust him today. Maybe by faith you could invite Jesus into your life. Maybe you renew your relationship with him. Look deeper in the box. Maybe you won't get what you want. God will give you what you need. God, I thank you for this amazing, amazing, amazing story. I thank you for this book, the Bible. I thank you for how all these stories work together to show us how you have worked through history to restore the relationship with you and broken people like us. I pray for those today who need a fresh touch of redemption in their life, who need a touch to know that you're there, that you're aware, that you care, that you're walking with them in this time of loss, who wanted a toy, didn't get what they wanted. Thank you that you give us what we need. Thank you that this bread and this cup says everything, that ultimately this is all we need, your son, Jesus Christ. And we lift our prayers in his name and for his sake. Amen.